With anti-rotational element, if you don't have a hex, you don't know the orientation of the screw channel, the crown will be rotated. So you need to use the angulated multi-unit, for example.
Hello and welcome back to Uniqa Dental Show, where we discuss interesting cases and new procedures in the field of dentistry. Don't forget to send us your cases so we can review them. With us today is Dr. Yaniv. Hi, how are you?
Great, how are you doing?
So, what did you bring us today?
Today, we're going to show a case when we want to make a restoration on a single frontal tooth. In these cases, if we want to make the restoration from zirconia, the only part that we can use is the T-bases. And today, we're going to show different types of parts and where each type of part we can use. In this case, we used a T-base with an angulated top because you can see already here that the implant is buccally inclined and the screw channel will come right in the middle of the tooth. If you won't change the angulation of the screw channel, it would come out right in the middle of the tooth. So in this case, we wanted to show that not always we need to change the inclination of the screw channel to the palatal area, but sometimes when we have lower smile line, we can angulate the screw channel, not palatally, but buccally. And this way, when the patient smiles, you won't see the screw channel at all.
If you make only one tooth restoration on one implant, single tooth, will it hold? Like it's only one tooth?
Yeah, it will hold, but because it's only one tooth and only on one implant, in most of the cases, we don't want to do it with the medial loading. We want done to make the implantation and right away the restoration. If we are going to make it, we'll want to have a smaller tooth that won't touch anything, because in all types of movements, in eating, speaking, chewing gum, you have big forces applied on that single implant. And the highest failure rate in implants is probably in the immediate loading ones, is in the frontal areas, in the frontal teeth, when you load just one implant, for example, say central incisor.
After, if it's not immediate loading, you can take the same pressure, it won't rotate on its axis.
No, in these cases, the most important part is when you use a T-base, you want to have a T-base with a hex, with anti-rotational element between the implant and the T-base, so it won't rotate. If it won't rotate, it won't unscrew. If you have a round T-base for a single implant, it can rotate, and these micro movements can unscrew the screw, and the crown will start moving. When the crown starts to move, if the patient bites on the crown in wrong angulation, you can break the implant, you can break the screw in the implant, you can have many failures, and in some cases, you won't be able to restore in this implant.
So, how you took impressions?
Well, in this case, we took impressions with the intraoral scanner. You can see the scan abutment and the positioning of the scan abutment in the mouth. This case is probably the ideal case for the restoration to learn how to use the intraoral scanner, because you have all the teeth, you have only one scan abutment, you can scan it quite easily, you won't have any interference between the teeth and the scan abutment. In many cases, when you have only one implant and when you have approximation between this implant and the tooth, you'll have a problem with the scan abutment, because the scan abutment won't fit, it would touch the tooth, and if it touches the tooth, you're not sure that the impression you're going to take is accurate. Maybe you'll have inclination of the scan abutment, for example. So you take off the scan abutment some material. In this case, it is not the case. It is perfect for first-time users with intraoral scanners. All the scanners probably can take impressions for single implant, even the old ones, the new ones, of course. And you can just make the restoration, use the libraries, and It will be simple and you get to know the how to use the intraoral scanner.
And it's an implant level scanner.
Yeah, of course. If you take on single implant, you have to take on implant level because you need to know the orientation of the hacks. Everything is based in single tooth restoration on anti-rotational elements. You must have anti-rotational element between the implant and the T-base. Mm-hmm. In this case, it's a hex. It's an implant with internal hex, and you have a hex in the T-base. You have later on an anti-rotational element between the T-base and the crown. The T-base is not round all along. So you need to have anti-rotational elements between each of the parts. So if you use scan abutment, you have to use it on implant level and to have the scan abutment with an hex. If you don't have a hex, you don't know the orientation of the screw channel, the crown will be rotated.
We see the screw channel?
Yeah. In here you can see the provisional crown, the PMMA crown that was milled on the T-base. You can see the screw channel. It goes right in the middle of the tooth. Mm-hmm. And because the you have buccal inclination and the angulation of the tooth is parallel to the implant, the screw channel looks much bigger because the cut of the screw channel is elliptic. You can see in the left simulation that if you cut the screw channel angularly, you'll have an elliptical screw channel. So the surface of the screw channel will be much bigger and you'll have a bigger problem for this screw channel. Because you need to mask it, you need to close it, it will be seen. And in this case, the screw channel will be right in the middle of the tooth. So in here, what we wanted to do is we wanted angulate the screw channel, not palatally, because in this case, you don't have enough place to angulate it more palatally. You can't angulate it right to the most palatal area. In this case, you want to angulate it to the opposite direction, because if you angulate it to the buccal part, the screw channel will go up and the surface cut of the screw channel will be much smaller. Mm-hmm. So if the patient doesn't have high smile line, the screw channel won't be seen at all and you won't have an aesthetic problem.
So just fill it up and everything is very aesthetic.
Yeah, just fill it up. You won't see it at all. With time, maybe you need to change the material that closed the screw channel because it can absorb pigments, it can have slight color change.
But again, it depends on the patient's smile line.
Yeah, because if the patient has a high smile line, you don't see it. So if you have slight color change, it doesn't matter because you need to raise the lip.
From feedback that we receive, I see a lot of confusion considering the what part to use in which cases. Can you elaborate a little?
Of course. We have different parts for screw tendon restorations for different types of cases. So you have the T-bases and you have the multi-units. Every case will use the multi-units for cases when we have bridges, not for single crowns. We would never use for single crown a multi-unit, because we don't have anti-rotational elements between the multi-unit and the implant. Mm-hmm. For straight ones. In straight multi-units, we don't, as we talked before, we need to have anti-rotational elements between the implant and the abutment, and between the abutment and the crown. So in straight ones, you see that you have a thread and you don't have any anti-rotational element between the multi-unit, which is the abutment, and the implant. So theoretically, the multi-unit can rotate
and unscrew.
And unscrew. In the angled multi-units, in most of the cases, you have hex. You have an anti-rotational element between the multi-unit, which is the abutment, and between the implant. Mm-hmm. The multi-unit won't unscrew from the implant, but in the upper part, you don't have any anti-rotational element, so the crown can unscrew from the multi-unit. Mm-hmm. From all the multi-units that I know, you can't use the angulated multi-units and you can't use straight multi-units for single crowns. For single crowns, you only can use T-bases. Now, in the case of T-bases, you also have two different types of T-bases. The T-bases I'm talking about when we want to have a single crown is the T-base when we have an X between, which is the anti-rotational element between the implant and the T-base, and we have some anti-rotational element in the upper part of the, in the connection between the crown and the T-base. You have a variation of the T-base where you don't have an X, but you have a round surface, and you can rotate the T-base according to the implant. So these T-bases you can't use with single crowns. These T-bases you would use when you have parallel implants and you want to make a bridge on T-bases. Upper part of the T-bases also have a cut. Mm-hmm. You want the cut in the buccal area because when the implant is buccally inclined, this corner of the T-base will interfere with the design of the crown. You won't be able to move the crown palatally to have it in the arch. You want to have the crown in the arch, so in most cases you need just manually remove this part. In this T-base, this part is cut, so you can just place the T-base with the cut part to the buccal area and go forward with the design of the crown.
Okay, so I understood when to use the T-base, in which cases. So when can we use V-type and D-type? And when to use V-type and when to use D-type? And when to use both?
Let me explain about the differences between the V-type and the D-type. The D-type is more standard type of multi-unit. You have straight one and you have angulated one. That means that you can use the same sleeve for both of them and you have the same screw for both of them. So you can make a kit that has one type of sleeve, one type of screw. You have the different heights of the straight multi-units and you have different angulation and heights of the angulated ones. But everything, you can connect, assemble everything with everything. You use one type of sleeve, one type of screw, and different type of multi-units. In the V-type, it's not the case. Because for the V-type, you have different types of sleeves. Because the V-type is intended for cases when you don't have enough space or you want to make metal-based structures and you want the base of the structure to be as smaller as possible. Mm-hmm. So you have different types of sleeves. You have small sleeves, you have sleeves from 1.5 to 3, 4, 6 millimeters. You have different screw between the V-type and the D-type. So if you have a case that you don't have enough space, but in the posterior part you need to use the angulated multi-unit, for example, you'll have two types of screws. It can confuse a little bit because the screws looks kind of the same. It's hard to know what screw goes where. It leads to different types of mistakes.
V-type is best used when you don't have enough space or for metal structures. The D-type can be used in every other case. The angulated also.
Yeah, if you like need 4 on 4 on 6 when you have enough space.
Mm-hmm. And T-base is best used when you need anti-rotational designs.
Single crowns. Only single crowns.
Only single crowns.
Yeah, you can use the T-base without the hex for multiple implants, but they need to be parallel because you won't be able to fit the bridge on top of these multi-units. But it's not always recommended because you don't know the angulation of the implant. You can use the V-type with the D-type, but in this case you need to write everything down and you need to know what goes where because it has a lot of different parts. A lot of different parts leads to a lot of confusion and can lead to mistakes where the doctor doesn't know what goes where and the bridge won't fit and he doesn't know why.
Okay, so let's get back to our case.
Yeah.
This is the temporary restoration, I see.
Yeah, you can see that the crown color is not perfect. It was milled from PMMA. The screw channel is closed with composite material. You can still see the difference between the screw channel, probably because the picture was took with a lot of light. You can see it. Probably if the patient smiles, no one will see.
Like here?
Yeah. In there, you have less light. You almost can't see the screw channel. That's why we moved the screw channel, not palatally, but buccally. we raised the screw channel. So even in the highest smile that the patient has, you won't see the screw channel. You can see here that the crown is not in the arch with the implants because the lower teeth interfere a little bit, but the design of the crown probably will be the same. We will want to move the crown a little bit palatally because we want to mask the difference between those two teeth. And we want to have them on the same level. So that's what we talked about before. The T-base corner is cut. So the cut gives us the option to move the crown palatally.
Which gives us more aesthetic
option. Yeah, because of this option, we can move to the same level both of the crowns. Yeah, and here you can see the zirconia crown. You almost don't see the screw channel.
I don't see, maybe you see, because yeah. You're a dentist.
It's the first thing I look in a woman. you almost don't see the screw channel, but with time you'll see a little bit of difference. So maybe in a few years, 5-10 years, you'll want to change the composite material that closes the screw channel, but in the next few years, it won't be seen. Even when he smiles, you don't see it. You can see that in the final work, we moved the crown because we had this space in the buccal area. We moved the crown more palatally, so those both teeth are almost in the same level, even though the original teeth was not. You don't see at all. You can see in the reflection that it's not in the exactly flat.
Yeah, but it really looks almost natural. And it's zirconia.
Yeah, it's from the monolithic zirconia.
Thank you for being here today.
You're welcome.
Thank you for being here today. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and follow us. Feel free to send us your interesting cases so we can review them.